With that, it gives me great pleasure to invite and introduce you all to Amit Sharma. Hi, Amit. Nice to see you. Hopefully, you can hear us. Right? Right. Amit, you know, it's a pleasure to talk to you always. Every time we have a conversation, there's something new that I learn. By the way, Amit, folks, is the director of Global AI Accelerator at Ericsson. In fact, it is interesting that a company like Ericsson has set up a global artificial intelligence accelerator in this country, and Amit leads that. Would love to hear more on that if we get a chance, Amit. Before that, Amit was a vice president and also a chief data scientist at ADP. Most of you know ADP as the HR, HCM company, right? Human capital management, or you know, payroll processor, to be more specific. I think a lot of people are familiar with ADP in the context of payroll processing and HR related workflows. Amit comes with complete hands-on experience in data science, in machine learning, right from building models and applying them into in very specific industry verticals, right? And it also is a proud moment for me to say that, you know, Amit is an IPL alumni, right? So he's also gone through a program at IPL and is now in a leadership role. So welcome, Amit, and thanks for joining. I'm sure it's a busy day for all of us, and thanks for taking your time. But before we, you know, you start your presentation on the five key skills for data science manager, I'd like to take a quick poll of the audience here to see what, you know, what our audience consists of, where, you know, essentially from, let's say, from a work experience point of view, right? So that gives us some insights into do we have people dominantly from early stage careers, mid careers, or looks like we have predominantly 10 plus years work experience, which is pretty interesting. And it's not surprising because that is pretty much how we've been seeing for most of the sessions so far, right? So this is purely work experience, not necessarily revealing anything about what their current functional roles are or not. But maybe we should also try and understand that, right? But before we get to that, Amit, you know, the phrase data science manager is kind of interesting because the moment you say data science, people understand what data science is, right? At least they have a notion of data science means, you know, machine learning, AI, and all these buzzwords that come in, models, algorithms, and everything. And then the moment you start saying manager, what typically comes to mind is people manager, large teams, you know, authority, power, and all those kind of things. Now, when you put all of these things together is what I think is interesting. So before you jump in and demystify this for us and also help us understand what those key roles, skills are, I think it'll be good to take a poll from the audience again to see, you know, what they think and they understand about which of it best describes their, you know, understanding or sentiment around data science, right? Data science manager, specifically around that role. So let's just, audience, if you could quickly take that poll, help us understand, you know, the current landscape in terms of what your understanding is of data science manager. And then we won't hold you too long. I will stop talking and let the expert speak here. So until then, I encourage all of you to take the quick poll. I see only a few percentage of people doing it. It takes about a few seconds. Please go ahead and take that. So an interesting perspective that is emerging is, as you can see, Amit, many folks seems to think that data science manager typically means that it is a product manager with strong data skills and data understanding of data, right? But, you know, that may be the current understanding of the audience. Now, I'd like you to go ahead, start your discussion, presentation, and help us demystify this a little bit for us.
All right, sure. Thank you. Good evening, everyone. Thank you. Thank you, Sai, for the kind introduction. Thank you, Pinkesh, Manika, and Team PLF for having me on board today evening, and congratulations to all of you for pulling this great product leadership festival together, you know, and Data Edition particularly excites me as much as you. So without much ado, let me get into the topic of discussion, you know, today. And I'm glad that most of you actually answered that it is a product manager role with a data science knowledge. You know, this is exactly what I would have voted for, except we are not allowed to vote, so panelists, but that's my thinking too. So let me quickly start sharing my screen here. And as we get into the discussion today, the only caveat today is I am on a third connection. For some reason, my landline has given up on me, and I am keeping my fingers crossed.
So your voice is
with back such providers like Airtel and Vodafone of the world.
So I mean, just
going today. With that, let's get started.
Now, Amit, can you hear me?
This is...
Amit, 1 minute. I think your voice is quite choppy. So what I suggest is if the network bandwidth is an issue and, you know, it can happen at the worst of the times.
My voice...
Yeah, maybe you could turn off the video... To maximize the bandwidth for your slides and voice. Would that be okay?
Yes, I can hear you. Yeah.
Amit, can you hear me? There is a...
I can turn off the video for a moment, right?
Yeah.
Let me... Is this better? I have turned off the video for that. Improved audio. Is this any better?
Yeah, it seems a little better. Let's listen.
Yes, I can hear you.
Okay, Amit. So what I was suggesting, Amit, is you could probably can you hear us? You are on mute. You need to unmute.
Can you hear me all right?
Yeah, I can hear you all right. If you think the bandwidth is going to be an issue, what I was
suggesting, I'll turn off the video.
You can turn off the video and do that. Yeah.
The funny thing is I was able to hear you all through, but unfortunately you weren't able to. So I'll do that. Yeah.
Yeah. Thank you.
Without much ado, let me jump right into that session. And there we go. Let me just, how do I hide video?
You can say stop video.
Okay. So hello everyone. And thanks for the opportunity. Again, let me just quickly get to the discussion points here. The five key skills to become a data scientist.
Sorry, you should share the screen, your slides.
I'm not sharing yet. Okay. I'm sorry. That's my bad. Give me one. Able to see my screen now, Sai?
It's coming up. Yes. Yes, we can. Yeah.
All right. Hopefully there won't be any more quirks to deal with for today evening. All righty, guys. Hi, everyone. And once again, many congratulations on being a part of this session. I think it's equally exciting for me to be part of this interaction session. Now, I am glad that all of you talked about product manager with data science skills being the right way to think of a data science manager, because that's exactly what I believe it is, and also you will see along the course of this presentation. So, and just a bit of background about what Ericsson is. It's not like an unknown thing, but it's one of the leading providers of ICA, information and communication technologies, networking, managed services, digital services, billing, charging, and IoT space, in the IoT space, emerging business. So we are into that domain. The reason I call this out is because I'll be taking examples from this domain as much as from my past area of work, which is HR, analytics, payroll, and benefits, talent domain. So I'll be jumping between telecom and HR, and you have to bear with me when I talk of examples. And similarly, solutions, what do we do with AI in Ericsson? we are nowadays networks are becoming more and more complex. There will be about 24 billion, 5 billion connected devices in the next 2 years. So that speaks for how much connectivity demand is rising by the day. And to manage it is no more possible in a human, through a human capacity, which is why we look at AI to help us in making those decisions on the fly to optimize and route the network in the right way. 5G is pushing the limits on these kind of optimizations even more. And the same goes with self-organizing networks, where the networks themselves decide how to figure out the best way to handle the load. So without going into each of them, just wanted to give a taste of what kind of problems in telecom and Ericsson we used AI for. Now, I think the amongst the five skills, the number one skills is product management itself. And I'm glad for us having said thought that way. The reason is, I'll tell you the difference between a data scientist and a data science manager. A data scientist is, in my mind, a person who's capable of taking a problem and solving it using data science, technologies, techniques, platforms, and the code bases, frameworks, whatever it takes. But a data science manager has a larger goal. That data science manager is actually delivering a data science solution. So to know what problem are we solving, and this is product management 101. I don't even have to tell you guys, because you guys are the masters here in terms of what the product management is all about. But I have seen many a times, unless someone wears this hat, the problem is lost on them, and they jump into right into what data science problem should I be solving. It's a business problem that we are solving, and what are the business goals thereof. Quite a few times, it's just about, hey, which algo do I need to apply here? Algorithms come later. First comes the business problem. Also, the sense of who will be using it and how. I'll give examples, plenty of them, in terms of why these become important. If not us early on, we are going to bomb it. What is the targeted deployment? Is it going to be a hosted solution like a SaaS-based or on-prem? Think of it. An example would be you are asked to develop a security solution, which you are supposed to be using a surveillance camera, monitoring a breakage into the house, unwanted, suspicious burglary in the house. Now you, without thinking through it much, you take it to your teams and they start building a, CNN-based frame-by-frame analysis of if the intruder is actually intruder or a known person, and if it's an intruder, just identify one and send it back using GPUs and high-end processing and whatnot. But turns out this has to be installed in an ATM, which doesn't have internet connectivity, or even if it has, it wouldn't have the kind of hardware you probably use to train or inference it. It doesn't work that way. When you build something, you have to also have the target deployment. Where does it get deployed? Where does it get used? And who uses it? I think this is where such examples matter. Is it going to be on the edge inferencing versus something where you have a big data server farm where you could leverage hosted processing on, right? What is the support model? I think data science has come a long way, and I have seen it evolving in the last 8 to 10 years even more so, where instead of proof of concepts, we are actually talking about putting solutions back into the system. These solutions are actually augmenting what exists as a business solution. So if something does not work as expected, it is no more a proof of concept that works and everyone claps and it's over. It is a problem that AI is solving, and if it doesn't work the way it's supposed to, what is the support model? Who's going to manage the life cycle of the model? Who's going to retrain it? Who's going to rebuild it if it fails? Stuff like that. Licensing and timelines are equally important. I cannot emphasize enough on if you have a 6 month timeline to build something versus a 2 year timeline, the way you will approach it is very different. Okay. So this is nothing but knowing the big picture. And I would still think this is the most important trait a data science manager should have and should actually demonstrate when taking up a business problem. Second part, is formulating the data science problem. Again, first question one must ask is this a data science problem in the first place? I have seen quite a few times, in Ericsson itself, we work with many business partners, and some of them have come up with a requirement to provide a end-to-end automation more than a data science kind of a paradigm. It was a requirement where one needed to look up some data, come up with a outcome by querying that data, and based on that outcome, actuate a certain action. This was more of a RPA automation than really an AI ML problem. And if you and your team are responsible for solving AI ML problems more than automation needs, or augmenting automation with AI ML needs, you might want to reconsider whether this is a problem you and your team needs to take up. Remember, if you don't need data science, don't use it for the heck of it. Sometimes I've seen people bring in a huge complex model in place where a simple basic automation will work or the rule-based engine will work. If a rule-based system does it for you, please do consider not using a AIML-based solution, because AIML solution by nature is probabilistic. It's not deterministic, which means it will only perform to a degree of accuracy. And there is only as much as you can push the pedal on that. Once you've figured out, okay, it's a data science problem, the data science manager in you will be the product manager with the data science hat will ask, what kind of problem am I solving? Am I predicting a house price, a regression problem? Or let's say how many more COVID cases will be in the upcoming times? That's a regression problem versus classification. You know, is this a cat or a dog? Or is this going to be a case of COVID patient or not? That's a classification problem. And recommendation, is it recommendation? Are you planning to recommend a solution, a movie or an item for sale? So, and Sai, I will trust you to let me know if I have to stop for taking questions. I see a few hands being raised, but I totally trust you to tell me when it's time, right?
Yeah, absolutely. I think we'll take the Q&A at the end because I'm monitoring the LinkedIn thread where, awesome, you know, we ask people to post questions. Yes.
Awesome. Thank you. Yeah. So the data science managers are supposed to be looking at what nature of the problem is, because that will drive the need for what kind of a effort you can estimate, right? Is the data available? This is one question where many projects seem to halt. In my own experience, I would say if I have to let go of 10 projects, 8 of them were because of data availability issues. The availability issues could be due to many reasons, you know? It could be due to the fact that your regulations prevent you from accessing that data. Or because the data, you know, regulations again can be international, they can be within the company itself, sometimes because of the PII, the personally identifiable information may not be available to you. You have to be extremely careful in committing for a project or taking up a delivery on yourself or accepting a ownership of a project where data is not guaranteed to be available, which is needed to solve the problem, right? Again, this is one of the ingredients of building a solution. And if it's not made available, I know you will also say no to it. And finally, you have to, in data science projects, this is where it gets a little hairy. You know, the data science managers will take the business goals and establish the accuracy metrics and the potential trade-offs. Now, those of you who are familiar with data science know for a fact that there are various measures of accuracy. If it's a regression problem, it's a root mean square error. It could be a mean absolute percentage error. If it's a classification problem, it could be the precision and recall or F1 score or AUC area under curve. Do not get thrown away by these terms. They're extremely simple. If you see them in the purpose they solve, it's just that they end up, sometimes data scientists make them more complex than they are, or it's a log loss. But the end result is you want to establish those metrics which will be considered as success for a business goal. And also make the business, the person you are, the business you are working with, the potential trade-offs, like, hey, I can find these many COVID patients per day for you, but there will be these many false positives. Are you willing to take that cost? And similarly, there can be other way around. I may be able to give loans to, I mean, tell you that you can give loans to this many people, but are you okay with these many defaulters out of them? That percentage of true positive and true negative is false positive and false negative. That tolerance level has to be established with the business, and in each case, it will be different. I can tell you an example. In my previous life, when I was building this solution for identifying potential candidates for a job, the trade-off was I could flag, we had to identify, is this candidate fit for a job? Now, in the process of doing that, the trade-off is I can recommend every candidate or almost all the candidates, but then there's no point in using a machine learning because the HR was anyways doing that. They were going with every resume and deciding with whom to give a job to, or at least call to. But the point is, how much can I reduce the work while still not losing a potential candidate? At the same time, I cannot say, I will give you only the most interesting resumes. You will not have to go through anyone who is not relevant. I should not also lose out on some relevant candidate just because the machine is too choosy. So being too choosy versus too lenient leads to a false positive and false positive negative kind of paradigm. And we have to be extremely clear in our mind as to what those results are. The skills here, guys, is basic statistics and AI ML. Now, I will clarify towards the end of this presentation as to what I mean by that. But just know, it's not about being a data scientist yourselves. But if you cannot take away the need for understanding things like, you know, what is mean median mode or what is the root mean square error. Some of these things are hygiene. And I would say they are an arsenal. They are a weapon in everyone's arsenal, be it a data science product manager or not. Those in the data science business will know it a little more, but those a lot more. Those not also have to have these concepts handy, right? I mean, the financials work on pretty much these, quite a few of these statistical concepts, right? So we will talk about these skills in more details later, but just know basic statistics. What are the type of AI ML problems, regression, classification, recommender, like I told you, and understanding the accuracy metrics, the root mean square error, MEP. I just mentioned a few, but these skills are some things you look for when you take a course or want to learn yourself or go for an MOC. You want to understand accuracy metrics for sure. Otherwise, how do you validate the model? Hopefully that makes it clear. This was the second skill in your pocket after the product management one. The third one, how do you plan? The first question they'll ask you, so when can it be done? Can you give me a plan for it? The plan for data science projects, unlike the projects which we do for development, at least need to have a two-stage planning. The first stage is experimentation, and the second stage is execution. Now, if there's anything as a data, project manager, now this is a project management skill, but it's so important in data science projects that sometimes it gets overlooked and leads to, I think, many sad sides. The first problem is, if you do not experiment, you do not even know, your team doesn't experiment, they do not even know the feasibility of whether the hypothesis, and by hypothesis is a big word for the more simpler word called intuition, that, hey, can we find the right candidate for this job using AML? Or another hypothesis could be, hey, is it possible to predict a cell is going to go down, outage is going to happen in a cell tower so that I can route my traffic to some other thing? That experimentation needs to be done to establish the data science. And experimentation doesn't get done on boiling the ocean stage. It gets done with some sample data, sample yet real data. So that experimentation, once it's established, the results are understandably, palatable, and the business is okay with the results, is when you plan to execute and take it to scale, right? So how much time should we keep for your experiment? Depends. But the entry criteria is to have real data in hand. You cannot do any experiment on fake data, simulated data. They will be as good as the data that has been simulated. And if someone can simulate real data already, I don't know why they need machine learning. If someone could generate a picture of, I'm trivializing it, but think about it. Someone could actually generate cat and dog pictures on demand. They already know how to do it. I don't know what's the point in putting a machine learning there. So think about not accepting a simulated data unless someone is guaranteeing that it's as close to the real data as it can be. Sometimes a simulation can be based on some past data which is close to real, and by understanding its distribution, which may be okay in some cases, again, case by case. One more thing you need to plan for as a part of your project management hat when you wear as a product manager, you also need to think about failed experiments. Experiments by design are supposed to pass a few times and fail other times, right? So you've got to plan for it and not think that everything will be hunky-dory and we will get the results we want. More often than not, the first few iterations will be those of, not so satisfying results. It's okay, you iterate, but there is an experiment that we did. We try to predict the people who will be taking leaves, unplanned leaves. Planned leaves everyone applies for, so no point in predicting. But unplanned leaves, when we try to predict, it did not shape out as we thought it will. In fact, it shaped out very well for one part of the data, which was another learning from that when you take up data, you ensure its representativeness also. So like it should represent the actual population. So here we figured that the failed experiment was in terms of when we actually tried to build a model for a few more clients, it didn't do as well as it did on the first client for predicting absence, unplanned absence. We had to, failing fast is important. You cannot lurk over it. Fail fast, document it for others to learn from. You archive your findings, you share it with others and move on. You continue to try. I'm not saying fail and just give up, but do not try to, prolong the failure so much so that the client starts questioning you, right? That's the most important point. Ensuring the data availability and accountability is most important. When you, stakeholder management is one of the basic things, you will do in your product management curriculum. This is one of the most important parts. You have to establish who is the data guy for me and that person is accountable for making it available for the whole project. And also engage the subject matter expert from a, when you plan, you also have to plan a team, right? You'll have data scientists clearly. Engage a subject matter expert. Quite a few times people think they'll pull it off without that subject matter expert. No, it doesn't work that way. Right from being able to figure out which features work, which features don't work, which variables, input variables work, which don't, to whether the business results are actually making sense or not, your SE is the key person there. So anyone with a business hat who understands how the product works or how the solution is supposed to work is a good SME to have. And of course, you are going agile. I mean, agility is given. I'm not even going to mention it as an explicit point, but you have to keep bouncing the results with the stakeholders. So again, the skills are project, product management, and understanding the nature of data. If you do not understand the nature of data and assume that by nature, I mean, the data is characterized by the four Vs, right? Velocity, volumes, and all that, veracity. What you want to do is make sure that you have a good understanding of your data, the granularity and everything in the problems you are solving. If you don't take that into consideration, you may actually fail to perceive whether your data is a true representation of the population or it's just a biased sample and stuff like that. Okay, so that was the third aspect of third skill I was talking about. After product management, which is overall understanding the problem, formulating the data science problem, planning and tracking it. Now let's talk about validating the data science model. Now, this is where it really requires some data science skills, you know, beyond just glossing over things. Here, you have to, as a product manager, understand what's an overfit and not an underfit. Overfit is basically a model which works great, exemplary on training data, but fails miserably with test data, real data, when you actually try it in the production or unseen data. This is where you need to question the model's efficacy. Many people end up, managers get blinded by the developers or the data scientists telling them that, hey, this is like a, you know, my model is doing 99% data, don't report the test data, unseen data errors, and that's not acceptable. Underfit or a model with a lot of bias is also a problem because it means it's not able to explain the, generalize the problem well. You also need to create right validation split. By this I mean, suppose you're predicting, let's say, whether an employee will leave the company or not. This was another problem that we worked on. Or for that matter, even a cell is going to die or not, a cell tower is going to go bad. When you formulate these problems, typically the validation strategy is, I will take 30% of the data randomly, sample it from the total population, 70% I'll use for training, and 30% I'll use for testing. However, these are time series data. Some of these are time dependent. You know, in the real world, you wouldn't have a peek into the past to be able to predict the future. You'll only have past and present. You'll have to predict the future. You won't have future parameters or features. So that is where you need to decide that here I will use a time split. I will use data till 2019 as my train data and use 2020 as test data, unseen data. So test on truly unseen data. Otherwise, you are all only kind of postponing the problem and later it will fail sometime. Yeah. And one thing I have added to my list, I keep on talking about these skills. When you validate the data science model as a data science manager, you demand explainability. At one time, it used to be, you know, fine if you have explainability, if it's a business requirement. But in my recent experience, I have seen as a data science manager, if you demand explainability quite a few times, it brings out for the data scientists themselves the key insights into their model, which means they end up looking into their model and saying, hey, maybe the features it is thinking is important are not the most important features. Along with SME, they are able to improvise on their models by demanding explainability. But how do you explain models? If those of you in data science will know, model explainability is very beautiful with linear regression, maybe logistic regression, decision trees, which are rule-based. But the moment you go past the decision trees into random forest realm, the realm of ensembles and neural networks, deep learning, explainability is totally blind. You know, it's a black box prediction. However, good news is in the recent past, we have had many strides made, rapid strides made. It's a hot topic. How to explain? There is this, you know, very interesting case of how a model was doing so well when trained on, you know, Husky's data versus Wolf's data, showing a picture Husky versus a Wolf, it would do so well. But in a stadium, when a real Wolf came, it failed and thought it was a Husky. Just because no one bothered to see if it was, how was it learning the picture or image? It ended up figuring, when they really applied explainability, they figured that it was learning the background and not the object itself. So it was not learning whether it's a dog, husky dog, or a wolf. It was learning that if it's a snow, most likely it's a wolf. If it's green, it means a homely or a domestic background, and it's a dog. When the explainability came, it's a goosebump moment for many data scientists. Oh, it's really learning the background and not the main object. So again, you have to demand explainability. In fact, text mining also, which features are being used for explaining the outcome, is very important. Here the skills are, I'm still calling them AI ML basics. I'm asking you to demand explainability. I'm not asking you to do it yourself. You ask them, show me the picture, show me the hotspots. On what basis it's showing if it's image recognition? If it's text mining, on what basis it's saying that it's a atheist or a hardcore Christian? I mean, if the keywords come up as an email ID, you know that, hey man, it's learning email ID. How can you tell that based on email ID someone is a Christian or a atheist? A believer, let's put it, Christian may still be figured out, but a believer versus an atheist. So you have to just demand these things. You have to demand. Can you tell me how much is the precision on the test data, not the train data? I don't want to hear about train accuracy. That's the kind of questions you need to ask. How did you split your validation set? Questions like those, right? Have you tried your unseen data? Alrighty, so we come to the final point about operationalizing the model. Now, this is also very important, guys. It may not have been important 7-8 years back because most of the models were proof of concepts, or people generally tend to be extremely happy. Organizations are happy when something has been built as a proof of concept several years back. Now, it is being put into production more than ever. And when that happens, you are talking about how to scale. I mean, are you going to do it for one user versus millions of users? Are you building a recommendation engine like the Amazon or a Netflix movie recommender, where the scale is as important as the quality of the thing? Then how do you make a microservice out of it? Again, you don't have to solve the problem, but you have to ask your team, have you planned how will it work when it goes to a scale like the one we need it for? Model lifecycle management, the fundamental question, right? Will the model always work? You will be lucky if a model you built on data for the last 10 years will continue to work for the next 10 years. I'll tell you, more often than not, the model has a concept drift. And by concept drift, all it means is the network data, network is because I worked on a problem like that. The data distribution changes and the nature of the problem changes with time. People leave a company, what they used to leave 20 years ago is very different from what they are leaving for today. In fact, one of the problems we were solving for one of our clients was predicting the number of customer complaints on the network, like call drops or poor network. Can we predict the number of customer complaints? We built a model back in September, and by the time we reached March this year, the model had to be redone to be able to come up with the same accuracy, because the underlying network design had changed, the number of customer complaints and the distributions had very drastically changed. So we've got to put those considerations. And what if it changes? Are we thinking of a solution? If you have worked, if you're building a solution end to end, you will have to think of Airflow kind of a, or any lifecycle management, ML flow, Airflow from Airbnb. They are lifecycle management tools, or you have to build your own. But you have to detect the concept drift by looking at data shape changes, data distribution changes, and refresh the model. If you might also end up doing rebuilding the model. Again, it depends on your post-op support model, which means what did you agree with your client on? Was it, were you supposed to handle it after it goes into production, or were you supposed to just toss it over and it's their headache, right? So those questions have to be asked upfront and handled later. How are you going to monitor and set alerts based on the model performance? This is also extremely important. You are not going to just be like leaving the model as is. Sometimes you want to be aware of something going wrong much before the client comes back and tells you, hey, it's going north or south. Licensing and pricing is also important because, depending on licensing scheme, you will decide how the model will be served. If it will be on-prem or hosted, and based on that, you can decide whether it will be a subscription-based or it will be on-prem. You just take it and will just notice the number of calls my model being made, stuff like that. And model protection. One more thing, we protect our code. We have to think of our models also. There are so many model attacks these days, adversarial, and people trying to, just like they decompile Java code, they're trying to decompile the models and figure out how it is working, the underlying mechanics, the weights of the model, if you will. You have got to go for protected AI in that case. Again, I'm not saying you got to solve all these problems, but at least have a checkbox. And these are the skills These skills are more about software risk management or model lifecycle awareness. If you're aware of how the software project is built and delivered, I'm pretty sure think about protecting your code, licensing your code, pricing it right, monitoring it, managing the post ops, and how you scale it. The same considerations here, except in the data science realm. So which is why you just need to think from a data science standpoint. And this is where you will realize that we have kind of covered 5 skills, and they are not extremely different from a product management lifecycle. However, they differ in the sense that there are some extra considerations. There are a few distinct skills need to have had to be able to deliver those, and which is why we call them out and try to. So I use the word basic AI ML skills quite a lot. So this is last but one slide. So I'm going to spend a moment here and tell you that. What do I mean by basic AI skills? And this is not even a comprehensive list, guys. Do not come after me if I tell you that something is missing. The most important part is you will get my drift here. I am expecting folks to have statistical analysis techniques. What is meant by mean or a median mode? How is the median different from a mean? Or what's the probability mean? You know, what is a narrow confidence interval good or a wide confidence interval good? These are the questions as a basic statistician, you should be able to just get it. P-value. It might seem like a deep concept, but it is not. It is not, you know. And Bayesian thinking, it's a very interesting. You just Google up Bayesian thinking if you don't know already, and they will give examples of how likely is someone to have cancer if they tested positive for cancer. You'll be surprised how different it is from what you think if you are not aware already, right? Data distributions, normal, binomial, Poisson, there are many more, but we are just talking about a few discrete distributions. Machine learning versus rule-based programming. You've got to figure this. There's nothing helping if you don't understand the fundamental difference between machine learning and rule-based programming. Rule-based programming is what we do. We've been doing all this while. Machine learning is where it learns from the data. What are the various types of models? Just a conceptual understanding. You don't have to have a mathematical underpinning. I don't know for every model how it works at a mathematical root level. I do have a under the hood understanding, but it doesn't make me really as knowledgeable as someone who would have worked on a single model for all life, right? But it should be at least understood that, okay, this is where I pick up a different model. This is where it makes sense to use a recommender engine. Error metrics I talked about, root mean square error, mean absolute percentage error, precision, recall, F1 value, AUC, some of the basics, log loss, and what are the model validation techniques, how to detect overfitting, how to demand the right testing results and stuff like that. So to summarize, I've just put the slides here. I thought this was an interesting way to just put a nutshell. Knowing the big picture like you always do as a product manager, formulating the data science problem, this is where your data science skills come into kicking in. Planning and tracking, not making mistakes of working on unreal data or a fake data, and ensuring data is available, engaging the SME in the team. Validating the DS model, how to validate, avoid overfitting, how to work on unseen data, demanding explainability, and finally, scaling it. Operationalizing it, thinking about the post-op support, thinking of protecting your model, licensing, monitoring, stuff like that. So that's pretty much it, guys. I really appreciate your patient listening, and I'm all ears for questions at this time. Hi, over to you.
Well, thank you so much, Amit. I think very prescriptive, followed stages and what skills are required in each of it. I'll try to summarize it because I've been learning, making notes. So hopefully people can, again, recall this. But before that, I think, one or two minutes on, my understanding, and help me correct sure. me if I'm wrong here, is when we say data science managers, right? So on one side, there is a set of constituents who say product managers needing to understand data skills more. Right. And mm-hmm. some of the skills that you outlined. But on the other hand, in many organizations, if you see, there is a struggle between, business leaders and the data teams, data professionals in mm-hmm. a common language. Right. Because, often when the business leaders are talking something that gets lost in translation to the data teams and data professionals and vice versa, right? So a data science manager is somebody who is bridging that gap, right? With the technical expertise of data engineers, data scientists, data analysts, and at the same time with the business leaders to help them understand how the work that they do the sophisticated analysis mm-hmm. and everything that you do actually can translate into impact at scale at organization, right? So this is more of
absolutely. It's a bridge between the business leaders and the data science teams. You quite told it, and I think I may not have explicitly told it, but storytelling is where you understand data science and you understand business. As a data science manager, you are trying to bridge using your storytelling techniques. Again, it's a product management 101, but extremely important. Thanks for bringing that up, Sai. Yeah.
Great. So now I'll just quickly recap the ones that you said before we get into the audience questions. I see several questions, and hopefully we can also cover some of them. So you started off saying that the first important area is around knowing the big picture, right? And in that area, the most important skills is the basics of product management, especially around problem, understanding the problems. Why are we doing this? You know, should we even do this? Is this worth solving? And those kind of things, right? And then move on to the next stage where you have formulating the data science problem itself, right? So if you are not clearly defining what you are going to solve, what you are aiming on, what is the desired outcome, then all of that. And in that area, you emphasize some of the skills around statistics and AI, ML problem and accuracy metrics, understanding accuracy metrics, where you said it's going to be very important.
Decision recall, correct.
And the third important area that you emphasize is now that you have formulated the data science problem, now it's all about planning. It's all about project management. It's all about tracking it, defining the workflow, defining the milestones, putting together resources, people, money, everything. It's all project management, right? And again, here you come up with experiments, hypotheses, testing.
Exactly. Right? That's the most important, Right. Planning to experiment is very crucial. You said it right, Satish.
And then stakeholder management, because, you know, at every point in time, I believe what you are saying is it is not just working with your team of data professionals, but there are lots of other stakeholders, right? From either from a product management side or either from a business side. Now you need to continuously help them understand what the progress is, what the return on investment is, because this is a challenging role here, right? And the fourth area, what you mentioned, is validating the data science model. Now here, I think pretty interesting what you said is now you need to really have at least a working understanding of AI and ML skills, right? So it's not just enough if you know at a very superficial level, because now as a data science manager, you are going to demand explainability. I like that word, demand explainability, right? And if you are asking such questions to your data team, you better understand what they are talking to you.
You better understand. This is very important, and it's become a hygiene factor lately because quite a few projects of nature data, they end up being like, I need 600 features, I need a GPU, but the manager has to ask, oh, so what's the feature on feature improvement in accuracy? What you're doing is 600 features, what would happen if I picked up the top six features and still made it happen, right?
Right.
If the loss in accuracy was only 1%, that's it. You said it. Yes,
one needs to have data. And the ability to even comprehend and understand and ask such questions is important, right? And,
very important.
And finally, you're talking about operationalizing the model. Now, so I like the way that you said that gone are the days where you are doing prototypes, POCs and all. Now you are talking about at scale, right? If you're not developing these things at scale, then it's still a lab project, right? So not necessarily something that can bring business impact.
Yeah, and it has to be integrated into the project product, maybe.
Absolutely.
And those are the things.
Production quality, you know, not in anymore POC quality experiment type thing, that is production quality, and hence
production again, quality.
Project management plus I think model life cycle understanding is what you emphasize.
Yes, absolutely. Right?
So
absolutely.
If that is the summary that I could give for others.
That's beautifully summarized. Thank you.
Thank you. So there are a few questions that I think we could take. I see, you know, Rajrita Datta has asked pretty similar questions that we went through. Now, I think the basic question is, can somebody, you know, two things. Can somebody who started as a data scientist or a data analyst today and data engineer, right? And can to build a career in data science manager role, you know, is there anything beyond the skills that you outlined? And also how does one go about acquiring these skills? If I can add to that question, what they're asking.
So I think if someone started off as a data scientist or a data analyst role already, the good news is they have some of these skills already as much as knowing data science goes. However, being a manager or a leader, product leader, if you will, takes a bit of experience and a lot of maturity in terms of actually figuring out the business problem, managing stakeholders, communication skills, storytelling, formulating the business ideas problem. So these take some experience. And obviously, I think, you know, this is where learning from the experts also helps, because sometimes you can fast track your career by learning from people instead of learning it by your own experience. So I would say this is where I would look up to what my learning on product management was with IPL. That helped me figure out that asking the right questions or going out and interviewing, not waiting for, not sitting in the room and just thinking of myself the requirements, but actually interviewing the user who's going to use my, these skills come with learning from the experts and time as you experience more and more delivery challenges and thereby build on them, plus your DS skills to become a successful product manager with data science, for data science. That's my take on it, Sai. What do you think?
So one question Shishir is asking is, how important is domain knowledge to be able to be effective data science manager? Is that important, you know, the skills that you outlined, both in terms of technical skills and non-technical skills, especially around storytelling, data visualization, and being able to stakeholder management, all of that. So how, what is the importance or the role that the domain knowledge plays here?
Domain knowledge plays paramount role. So does it mean that if I don't have the domain knowledge, I may not become an effective data science leader? That's probably a little nuanced question, because it may not be a black and white. And which is why I called out the need for having an SME on your team and being connected with the right business, both stakeholders as well as leaders in your team, to be able to drive it. See, as a data science manager, I should have domain knowledge to the extent that I appreciate the problem I'm trying to solve. I may not be a domain expert. And I think domain expertise will be far and few. Combining AI, ML and domain and everything, a product management skills in one person is like trying to create a unicorn. It happens over a period of time, but it takes its time, right? And someone like, you know, one who invented GANs, for example, he moves from one company to another in a very different domain. So does it make him any less of a data scientist or a data science manager? Even data scientists require domain skills. So if you you know, ask bluntly, yes, all of them need domain skills, but they can do without it. Yes, if they're augmented with the right SME in the teams, you know. So I would say leverage the SMEs, use your own domain knowledge, but leverage them to validate your understanding. And that's where a data science manager is using data scientists to do the data science work, data analysts to do the data analysis work, using the SME to get the things validated. But overall, is kind of a broad stroke player, being able to work with all of them and make sense of all of it, not being an expert themselves. That's my take.
They awesome. Don't have to be expert. Yeah. No, excellent. I think that's helpful. So you're essentially saying domain knowledge is important. If you have it, that is good. But if not, you really need to work very closely with your subject matter expertise, experts in your team, and without which it's going to be quite a difficult thing. Excellent. I think we are close to the top of the hour, but before we go, Sonal, can you start sharing the screen so that we can announce the awards, please? And then before, so I see our next panelists are on. Just give us a few minutes, guys, so that we wrap this session and start going. Thank you again, Amit, for your insights. Definitely helpful, very prescriptive, 5 skills. So people who want to move into data science management career roles, certainly helpful around that.
Thank you.